dedicated to. Tasha, Oden French, my 32-year-old, beautifully healthy pregnant friend, who passed away in childbirth after the hospital induced her labor with a drug that was not FDA approved for that type of use. And that's what my documentary is about. So, this song is for you, Tasha.
Let's start from the very beginning. This is my childhood friend, Tasha Oden French. Our families lived on the same street on the south side of Berkeley, California, and we shared quite a bit in common. Besides being the same age, we both had a black father and a white mother. We went to the same schools. We both played the flute, and we were both the oldest child in our families.
From day one, she was really alert and curious. I was a single mom on welfare, and so she didn't have a lot of toys and stuff. And I remember her climbing in the kitchen cabinets, find stuff, and of course throw it out. But just had a lot of fun with everything in life that was around. Every time she walked in a room, it just lit up. Everybody lit up. You know, she just had this glowing spirit about her. Mm-hmm.
The word that and the phrase that always pops in my head is fun loving. You know, we could fight like cats and dogs at home, and then once it came to, you know, when we got to school, you know, she was that protective sister that was gonna introduce me to all of her friends and make sure all of her friends, you know, were watching out for me.
Tasha was so good about taking care of herself. Also, obviously, incredibly intelligent and bright and curious, intellectually curious.
I met Tasha the summer before high school through mutual friends. She just was always really true to herself, grounded person. We would see each other from across a room or a party or something, and we would meet eyes, and one of us would start moving our shoulder and start going like this and meet each other midway and just start dancing. And that was just our thing that we did.
She always felt like she was my polar opposite.
Okay.
In terms of being the kind of person that seemed to find goodness everywhere she went. Mm-hmm. Like, she had this ability to make us all feel so much better about who we were. She made me want to be more like her in that way, which is kind of a different thing for me.
She meant a great deal to me as an older sister, an older sibling, as an example, as a great example of a strong, fearless black woman, as an intelligent black woman. It was great to see her and all the things that she was doing and accomplishing. She went to France, she went to Israel, she went to a few other places.
She was a very adventurous person. Her everyday work that she was doing in clinics and working with young people was all part of the mix of what she was doing. It was just always incredible about all the things that she was doing at one time. But she always had grace and you know, she would never, you know, be too tough on herself.
I would say that of my friends, that Natasha was, from my oldest friends, the most dramatic in terms of, you know, it's a phrase they say, but blossoming, like really, really coming into herself, just being so excited about learning and potential ways of helping people, really.
Well, eventually, we grew into adult women, and Tasha continued to be inspiring and successful by receiving her PhD in psychology and then getting married shortly thereafter. While maintaining a private psychology practice, Tasha began her prerequisites for medical school, and later that year, she excitedly announced that she was pregnant.
And what are you wearing?
I'm wearing my first pair of maternity pants.
Throughout her life, but especially during her pregnancy, Tasha was extremely healthy.
Well, number one, Tasha was in incredible shape.
there she was, just, you know, glowing and radiant, totally excited mother.
She was thorough in terms of preparing herself physically, mentally, spiritually, emotionally for, you know, the birth.
And she just, and she had this glow during her pregnancy that many pregnant women have, but she had it, you know, even more.
And I remember putting my hands on her belly and she was, you know, it's a lot when that baby is in there, and that was a big baby.
She was glowing most of the time. I remember her always cradling her abdomen.
So my sister, during her pregnancy, was a very happy person. She loves being pregnant. She took great pride in it. Because she was a very healthy person, you know, she wanted to make sure she had a healthy pregnancy. But in general, she was just always, I mean, she was a happy person all the time anyways. But during her pregnancy, it was great to just see her belly get big and all the things that she was going through. And
she read to the baby. She sang to the baby. She was going to use these 100% cotton diapers and inserts and stuff. No pacifiers. She wanted a natural birth. She didn't want any drugs. Definitely didn't want a C-section. She took childbirth classes, mm-hmm. and got a lot of exercise. And although she was a vegetarian for 15 years before that, she just went on this amazing health food kick. Everything had to be totally healthy and organic.
Throughout her pregnancy, Tatia had been the picture of health. But when her due date came and went, the doctor advised that Tatia go to the hospital for evaluation.
She really didn't think that this was the right time, and she didn't want to go through with inducing at all.
I asked her, because she was having a lot of trouble deciding, which is not like her, you know, whether to be induced or not.
In December 2001, Tatia was 32 years old and just under 2 weeks past her due date, when she entered a well-known hospital in Oakland, California.
It seemed to me that the nurse, I don't really know what her agenda was, but she just seemed like, you're wasting my time.
After feeling pressured by her nurses and doctor, Tatia finally agreed to give in to an induction.
She said to me, well, okay, we're gonna be induced so everybody can leave now. Don't call us, we'll call you.
I said, what did you decide to do? And she said, I went with the Cytotec because it was gonna have a quicker, you know, impact.
When the nurse said that they were gonna use Cytotec, I said, well, what's that? And the nurse says, well, it's perfectly safe. We use it all the time. I mean, they had put so much pressure on her. They even said, well, you don't wanna go home with a dead baby, do you? Mm. You know, and that kind of put her in a zone, I think, and I could see on her face that she was like really not understanding what was going on. None of us were, why they were putting so much pressure on her.
Tatia's mother, Maddie, went home to get rest and await the birth of her new granddaughter. As she was told that the doctors were going to perform an emergency C-section on Tatia.
About 4 o'clock in the morning, I wake up and I just kind of knew something was wrong.
When Maddie arrived to the hospital, Tatia was nowhere to be found.
We get up there and it was like an atomic bomb had dropped. Nobody was on the floor. No doors were open or anything. And then there was this one staff room with a glass, you know, a door with a glass window on it. And all the nurses and doctors or whoever were around the table in this room, and instinctively I just knew that they were, you know, this is the L&D staff and they were talking about something, because it was not the time when shifts changed. Shifts had already changed. So I go down to the room that I had left my daughter in the night before, and my son-in-law was there and he was crying and hysterical. There's no bed in the room. It's just a big old empty room, and there was blood on the floor, and I said, and one of her earrings. And I said, "Where's Tasha?" And he said, "She's gone."
Tragically, both Tasha and her daughter Zorah passed away on December 28, 2001. Tasha experienced an amniotic fluid embolism shortly after being administered her second dose of Cytotec. Tasha's doctor never informed her of the manufacturer's warning letter and the risks associated with inducing labor with this drug.
And then my mother got to the hospital and the doctor told her, and she just started crying and screaming, and I went into shock and probably spent the next decade in shock.
Just fell to my knees. Couldn't believe what I was hearing.
You know, and I just remember that day, that night, and just asking God for strength.
I said, "Oh, is it time? Should I come?" And he said, "She died. Better, she died." And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he said, "She died and the baby died." And I couldn't believe it.
And you know, there's always that moment when you kind of don't really understand what you've heard. And life just doesn't make sense. I remember walking into the funeral and thinking the last time all of these people were together was at Tasha's shower. Just how wrong it was. Just wrong on so many levels.
Cytotec is the brand name for the drug misoprostol, and it is intended for exclusive use in treating ulcers. However, obstetricians all over the world are using this drug to induce labor in pregnant women. If used, it can cause abortion, premature labor, dangerous hemorrhaging, or birth defects. Doctors who prescribe this drug are specifically urged by the manufacturer to inform their patient that they should not use this drug if they are pregnant.
I can't imagine that my sister really knew what she was being given. My sister was highly, highly intelligent. She was very health conscious of everything that went into her system. She was already a PhD in psychology. She was in the process of getting her medical degree. And so I believe that, you know, she was just looking forward to the birth. She trusted her doctor, who was another African-American female. And she trusted the medical system, that they would only give her something that was necessary and that she should have no reason to question what they recommended.
My understanding is that doctors are allowed to use these drugs for things that are not necessarily what they were designed or created for.
To further our documentary research, we sought the advice of professionals in the obstetric field. Dr. Marsden Wagner, a perinatologist who also served as a director for maternal and child health, had plenty to share on the topic.
The uterus, the womb, blows like a balloon has been blown too hard. It explodes. And when this happens, there's a very big chance the baby will die and a significant chance that the woman will die. This is a humongous obstetric emergency.
And you don't hear about it because most of these cases are settled out of court before it ever gets to trial. And it includes a gag order, which means that nobody involved in the case can say anything about what went on.
Ina May Gaskin, founder and director of the Farm Midwifery Center, located near Summertown, Tennessee, has spoken on TEDx and handled approximately 3,000 births. She also shared her thoughts with us.
The induction with Cytotec, also called misoprostol, this drug has been quite popular since the mid-90s in U.S. obstetrics and has spread beyond our country. The drug was never approved by the Food and Drug Administration for this use. However, off-label use is pretty typical.
So why is this drug being used on pregnant women for labor induction if it is not intended for this use? Tora Spigner is a labor and delivery nurse.
I know one of the main reasons we use it a lot is because it's inexpensive. Mm-hmm. It's a cheap form of induction.
Why is it cheap? It's cheap because the pharmaceutical company never had to spend the money to do an experimental trial on pregnant women.
But the problem is, once you give a woman the Cytotec, there's no way to take it back.
After Cytotec is inserted vaginally, it dissolves instantly, and there is nothing that can be given to reduce the usual violent and painful contractions wearing on the mother's uterus and depriving the baby of oxygen far longer than can be tolerated.
There's a lot of influence of money in our medical system, and I think that that's a major problem in the U.S. medical system.
Gloria LeMay is a contributing editor of Midwifery Today magazine and an advisory board member of International Cesarean Awareness Network.
We really didn't know a lot about it, but it was used, it started to be used. Nobody questioned it, that, you know, doctors would be responsible and would only use things that had been shown to be safe for humans.
This is Dr. Vicki Alexander.
And especially OBGYNs try to have births at the convenience of the OBGYN. Not everybody, mm-hmm. but many of them, especially in the larger institutions.
Unfortunately, Tasha's story is not the only one. There are many others around the world who continue to suffer from this drug that is not FDA approved for use in labor induction. Tina Clenaris Robinson shared her story.
I was simply told that they were using the drug Cytotec to induce my labor. I was never told the risks. I was never asked if I was never asked to give my consent. I was simply told that this was the drug that they were going to be using.
Anne Laurette is a French woman working with France Health Ministry in a fight against Cytotec.
I was induced with Cytotec in 2007 in a big French maternity. It was my first childbirth and I didn't know anything about Cytotec. I could not imagine that they would give me a drug that was not authorized for labor induction, and I had no idea of the dangers of this drug. The childbirth was a disaster. 24 hours after the first dose of Cytotec, they made me an emergency C-section because my son was in fatal distress. And after that, I had a serious hemorrhage.
During the making of this documentary, a man in Mexico City contacted me to tell me that his wife and his baby had just died in childbirth due to the off-label use of this drug. I also had the chance to attend a women's conference for survivors of pregnancy-related death or near-death experiences. During this conference, when we asked one of the attendees what touched her most about the conference, she shared with us the impact that Tasha's story had on her.
I think one of the hardest things for me to listen to was the mother who lost her daughter. I just did lose a child. I can't imagine. And a grandchild at the same time.
I think the message should be that life is precious, that profit and medical experimentation should never take precedence. the most precious thing that any of us have is life.
Tasha always told us that we were beautiful and intelligent and powerful. And I always hear that. It meant something to me. I believed it when she told me. And you can do that for someone every day. And it will change somebody's life.
Her spirit deserves to have as much joy around it, you know, more than the sorrow and the sadness, you know?
I like for this documentary to just know who Tasha was as a person who had an incredible impact through 2 years that she was here.
So it's important for women, for men, for families to understand that these types of drugs are out there, that they're being used and misused by a medical system that is more concerned about profit and their own efficiency than the health and welfare of the mothers and the patients.
One of the things I always talk to my patients about is that they always have the option to say no. As a nurse, my job is to be a patient advocate. And I have to advocate for you and your baby.
Mm-hmm. We have purpose in life, and we are here for a reason, or two or three or four or five reasons. Mm-hmm. And we need to live our life with love and with purpose.
I think the message to the world is that we can change. Mm-hmm. We can improve. We can constantly improve. When we grasp what are the most fundamental aspects of life and human relationships.
It has made me really recognize the preciousness of every single day. And I think of Tasha every day.
It's important now that we really, those of us who find our courage to speak up, those of us who can share our stories, it's important that we finally speak up about it, mm-hmm. so that we can start raising awareness, mm-hmm. so that women can start changing the way that they go into a birthing experience.
Mm-hmm. The message. The message is that this situation shouldn't happen. There's no reason in the world why the most technologically advanced country on the planet should have a maternal mortality rate of 50th in the world. And that means 49 other countries on the planet, including really small ones like the UAE, have less women dying in childbirth than the US does. That should not happen.
When Dr. Wagner was asked what he hoped people would learn, he said,
"Do not use Cytotec for induction of labor."
Tasha's story is a clear reminder of how important it is to be fully informed about the drugs that we are offered so that we are able to make fully informed decisions. We are hopeful that through the message of this film, that the lives of countless mothers and babies will be saved.
still be